I'd like to first begin today by expressing my grateful thanks to all those who fought against the emergency and for restoration of our constitution and our democratic way of life in the mid-70s. And the list is very long. It begins with, they belong to different political parties, the Congress, Janasangh, Socialists, Communists, and the list is very long. It begins with Jai Prakash Narayan, Morarji Desai, Atalji Advaniji, Madhu Dandavate, George Fernandez, Nanaji Deshmukh, Ram Krishna Hegde, Viju Patnaik. They came from different states actually. Great stalwarts, Sikandar Bhakt. In the present government actually, we have many people who went to jail and who offered resistance. It begins with Prime Minister Narendra Modi, who ran the underground movement. And then Prakash Javadekar, now the Minister for Information Broadcasting, Ravi Shankar Prasad, the Minister for Telecom, Ram Vilas Paswanji, the Minister for Consumer Affairs. In the Sangh Parivar, there are a lot of people. And the tallest and the eldest of them, I think, is Advaniji, who along with Atalji was arrested in Bangalore and he was there in jail for 19 months. Then we have Arun Jaitley, Dattatreya Hosabale, and thousands of others. And among those who stood up against that regime, one of them has just arrived, D.P. Tripathi, my dear friend. There's a story about him which I will tell you later. So, the other point is that out of 6,370 political prisoners, there were 1,10,000 who were arrested under MISA. Out of them, the political lot was 6,370. Out of them, 3,250 were from the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh. What that means to you, you can yourself imagine. This is available in Annexure 5 of my book. It's available outside. And that has the document giving the details of who came from which this thing. So, to begin the story of the emergency, it all began on June 12, 1975, when Justice Jagmohan Lal Sinha gave his verdict in the Indira Gandhi election petition case. He held her guilty of corrupt practice. Corrupt practice under our election law deals with many things. If you use government servants for your campaign, it's corrupt practice. If you do this, if you use government facilities, it is corrupt practice, and so on and so forth. So he found her guilty on many counts. And he first barred her from contesting elections for 6 years. And so on and so forth. There are many other things in that judgment. Then when her lawyers pleaded, he also gave a stay of his own judgment for 20 days that enabled her to go to the Supreme Court. And the vacation judge was Justice V.R. Krishnayar, the very celebrated judge. He examined the whole thing. He said, okay, you can, I'll stay this and it will be heard by a larger bench of the Supreme Court. But my dear Prime Minister, you cannot speak in parliament or vote in parliament, but you can continue as prime minister. That is when Jai Prakash Narayan, Morarji Desai and other leaders of opposition said that India cannot have a lame duck prime minister. You cannot speak in parliament. You cannot vote in parliament. What kind of this thing is this? So please resign. Accept the verdict of the court and resign. So the Indira Gandhi and the household decided that because by then Devkant Barua and others were saying that, you know, India is doomed if you are not the Prime Minister. So it all begins from that and our own desire to challenge the judiciary, not accept the judicial verdict and so on. Then you have somebody called Siddharth Shankar Ray who comes up with this idea. Just now Gurumurthy Ji was saying that there is another gentleman somewhere in the south, a very, with a mischievous mind who gave her the idea of using Article 352. So Article 352 said that if there is internal disturbance, you can impose an emergency. So Siddharth Shankar Ray mooted that. She went to the president and said, now come on, issue a proclamation. This was in the night of June 24, 25. And the president issued the proclamation. At 6 a.m. next day, she called the cabinet, not to consult the cabinet, but to inform the cabinet of what she has done the previous night. And they had already drawn up lists of political persons who have to be arrested. So, Advani ji and Atal ji, by the way, in Bangalore, they were arrested. Jay Prakash Narayan was here. Then Murarji Desai, Madhu Dandav, the whole lot of them were arrested and put behind bars. And they used a kanun called MISA, Maintenance of Internal Security Act. So, the first slide, please. Yeah, so the president issues an order suspending citizens' right to move courts for enforcement of rights under on June 27. So, if you see that, you know, Article 14, equality before law and equal protection of the law. Article 21, no deprivation of life or liberty except through procedure established by law. And Article 22, no detention without being informed grounds of detention. Once you knock these three pillars out, then there is no such thing as democracy left. In any democracy around the world, these are the pillars on which you find the democratic structure resting. So once you have no right to life or liberty, or once there is no equality before law, there is no democracy. So what Indira Gandhi government said is that all of us citizens cannot approach court under any of these provisions for enforcement of Article 14, 21, 22, etc. So that was it, and soon after that, the second slide, please. They started forcible sterilization. This began in a very big way and all over the country. And Sanjay Gandhi took charge. He said population is the thing we have to control, and the best way to control it is through force. And so the chief ministers were given quotas. The chief ministers gave their deputy chief ministers and ministers quotas. The ministers gave their secretaries quotas. The secretaries gave their directors and deputy secretaries quotas. And it came down to the Inspector General of Police, Inspectors of Police, and the Constable. So that is why India became a very unsafe place for men in 1975-77. What happened was the constables, these constables, police, and the school teachers had quotas to nab males and take them to Nasbandi camps. So what happens? You are waiting in Muzaffarpur bus stand and a police van will come and put you in and take you. This is just like how these municipal guys used to do to catch stray dogs. Just the same operation. And it went on all over the country and people were shocked. Those of you young people sitting in this audience, you cannot imagine. Just imagine after this show, you are out there on the road at some cafe or something, a police van will nab you and take you to and vasectomize you. This happened in lakhs of men. So India became a very dangerous place for men. And then there are a lot of stories about vasectomy and all those things, but we will move from there. We come to series of constitutional amendments. Article 38, it barred judicial review of the proclamation of emergency. First, you impose an emergency. Then you amend the constitution to say, you cannot go to court against my order. Then the next slide, please. 39th amendment. There are 38, 39, 40, 41. You must go and see four amendments of the constitution. Every amendment is meant to protect one individual called Indira Gandhi. The sole purpose of this amendment was to protect Indira Gandhi's prime ministership by preempting the Supreme Court that was hearing her election petition. As you know, Krishnan had referred it to a larger bench. Now her whole plan was to amend the constitution to tell the Supreme Court you cannot hear election petitions. So that is what that whole thing was all about. And so all laws pertaining to elections placed in the 9th schedule, this in 39th amendment, all election petitions before courts to abate. What happens then? A case of overspeeding to save the Prime Minister. This is the 39th Amendment. This is very interesting because those who know law and governance and how laws are made in the country will have an idea as to how this happened. This is slide number 4. Slide number 4, please. Yes. When I was in school, you know, there was this nonsense verse Solomon Grandy, born on Monday, christened on Tuesday, married on Wednesday, ill on Thursday, very ill on Friday, died on Saturday, buried on Sunday. So whenever something happened in a jiffy, you know, in 2-3 days, what, mangni, shadi, something, there's a Hindi saying. It's something like that. So this nonsense verse would be recited. This is exactly like Solomon Grandy. August 7, 75, introduced in Lok Sabha. Actually, if you introduce a constitutional amendment bill, you must give the House some time to consider it. No time. It's just introduced that very day. For 2 hours, it's a so-called debate. Friday, August 8, it goes to Raj Sabha. Again, some Namka was the debate passed. 9th, it goes to state assemblies. You know, there are some amendments of the constitution which have to be ratified by state assemblies. So, Indira Gandhi had already told all chief ministers, summon your assemblies on Saturday. Saturday, passed by state assemblies. Sunday, August 10th, president gives assent. There is no Sunday for the president. And then, why was all this hurry? Because August 11, Monday, Supreme Court began hearing Indira Gandhi's petition. Attorney General stood up and said, my lord, you can't hear this petition. The constitution has been amended yesterday. So forget about it. You don't hear this petition. And the court was informed that constitution had been amended and therefore it cannot hear the Indira Gandhi petition. Afterwards, this is the story of the judiciary, I will tell you. The judges validated the 39th Amendment and validated retrospective effect of 39th Amendment of the Constitution. It is unheard of, but that is what happened at that time. Then you have the 40th Amendment, 41st Amendment. 41st Amendment is amazing, actually. It said, any civil or criminal proceedings pending against a Prime Minister will cease now. That is, the Prime Minister of the day was my tenant. He owes me some 6 months of rent for my house which he had taken. I cannot sue him and get my house rent. Or if there was some criminal case against him or her. So that is what they did. Slide number 5, please. So this is the havoc that happened, you know, at that time. Now the other day I just saw that there is some Congress statement, Congress people are saying, alleging that Narendra Modi government used parliament as a rubber stamp during first session. And they hope that this trend will be reversed and only bills that are not, that will be pushed without necessary legislative scrutiny. All of us citizens of India, all of us sitting here who have responsibility towards this constitution and towards the democratic way of life, have every right to tell our government, sir, please don't use the parliament as a rubber stamp. But I don't think the Congress party, after what it did in 75-77, has any right to say this. We have a right. Citizens who have suffered that emergency phase and even other citizens who care for our democracy, we have that right. The Congress party does not have that right. That is why every time they make these statements, it stands up bold before my eyes. I wonder, what are these guys saying? Are they qualified to say it? Next slide, please. 42nd Amendment. Yeah. Now look at this, sir. This constitution cannot be questioned, amendments cannot be questioned in any court of law on any ground. Amendment of the fundamental rights chapter beyond judicial review. That means I will do anything I want with the fundamental rights. Then, parliament's power to amend the constitution is unlimited. It can addition, variation, repeal. Parliament has unfettered right to preserve or destroy the constitution. Next. Two, three things that happened in 42nd Amendment which many people are not aware. First thing they did was they abolished quorum in parliament and assemblies. That means one MP, two MPs can make law for you, or one MLA or two MLAs. Abolition of quorum is if you want to know that there is dictatorship in the country, you will know when the quorum rule is knocked up. Second, president can amend the constitution, slide number 7. No, go back. Yeah, president can amend the constitution if there were any difficulties in giving effect to the constitution as amended. The president may, by order, for up to 2 years, adapt or modify the provision to remove the difficulty. Have you ever heard of this? This is what Hitler did in Nazi Germany. He acquired the right to write and rewrite the constitution. Giving the president the right, you know, commending constitution is such a big rigmarole in our country, in our constitution. She just knocked that out and gave the power to the president, who was a rubber stamp president. So, and it also clipped the wings of the judiciary. Then we come to the habeas corpus case. This is where we have to deal with the judiciary. You see, Madhu Dandavate, L.K. Advani and all moved different high courts against their detention. All those cases, Supreme Court, A.N. Ray was the Chief Justice, he said, no, get all the cases here, we will hear them. So the Supreme Court heard those cases. And then the Niren Day, who was the Attorney General, said that after the June 27, 1975 order of the President, citizens' rights are suspended to move courts for enforcement of fundamental rights. So Article 14, 21, 22, this is slide number 8. Yeah. You cannot move court for, you know, life, liberty, personal, this thing, whatever, equality before law. None of these things you can move court. This is called Shivkant Shukla versus ADM Jabalpur. That's a very famous case. And that case was heard by a 5-judge bench. Chief Justice A.N. Ray, Justice Khanna, Justice Beg, Chandrachud, Bhagwati. In that order of seniority. So then what happens? Next slide, please. When the Attorney General said the citizens have no such right to move court for those rights under Article 14, 21, etc., Justice Khanna asked the Attorney General, suppose a policeman for reasons of enmity kills someone, would there be a remedy? The Attorney General says, consistent with my position, my lord, not so long as the emergency lasts. It shocks my conscience. It may shock yours, but there is no remedy. There is no remedy if you are shot dead. This is what the Attorney General is telling the Supreme Court 5-judge bench. That is why I think it's a matter of shame that there are people in this country who still go on defending the emergency after knowing all these things. This is the most disgraceful aspect. Then the verdict came. In that verdict, A.N. Ray, the Chief Justice, then Beg, Chandrachud, Bhagwati, all of them upheld the union government's view and held that no citizen has the right to move a habeas corpus petition in the light of the president's order of June 27. The only dissenting judge was Justice H.R. Khanna, who was the senior most judge after Chief Justice Ray. Slide number 10, please. And what kind of judges did we have at that time? We had a very strange kind of people in our judiciary, in our executive, you know, and in our politics. Here is Justice Beg. He says, we understand that the care and concern bestowed by the state authorities upon the welfare of detainees who are well fed and well treated is almost maternal. Even parents have to take appropriate preventive action against those children who may threaten to burn down their house. Justice Beg believes that all of us who were opposed to Indira Gandhi were going to burn down the house. He also believes that Jai Prakash Narayan, Atalji, Advaniji, Madhu Dandavate, Morarji Desai are all well-fed and well-treated in jails. And the attitude of Indira Gandhi is almost maternal. Almost maternal. Justice Khanna was the dissenting judge. And what happens to him? He was superseded for the office of Chief Justice in January 1977. And these other judges who let us down, who let the citizens down, Beg, Chandrachud, Bhagwati, all of them became Chief Justices of the Supreme Court. 1,11,000 persons were detained during the emergency and MISA and Defense of India Act. And this almost maternal judge became the Chief Justice of India. Then assault on media, slide number 11. So, 42nd Amendment took away all our fundamental rights. Then, Parliament Proceedings Protection of Publication Act repealed. This is what is called Firoz Gandhi Act. You know, Firoz Gandhi was our member of parliament in the 50s, and many of our elders in would meet him in Central Hall and say, there is no protection for us when we report parliament. These, you know, and you people criticize some industrialists, this, that, we get sued. There is a defamation case against us. So you have to do something. So Firoz Gandhi brought this private bill, which was accepted by the Nehru government, and it became law. It's called Parliamentary Proceedings Protection Publication Act, to protect media when it reports parliament faithfully. The first thing Indira Gandhi did after imposing emergency was to repeal this Firoz Gandhi Act. Incidentally, Firoz Gandhi was her husband. Prevention of Publication of Objectionable Matter Act. This was another extraordinary, horrendous law under which a district magistrate could just walk into your printing press and say, what is this? Close the press, and so on. And a lot of district magistrates' power went into their head, and there was a lot of zulm. Large-scale arrest of journalists and harassment went on. Then, I was a correspondent in Indian Express in Bangalore. I have said this earlier. The Inspector General of Police Karnataka, the Inspector General of Police Karnataka was made the chief censor. He had police inspectors with him and information department guys. Whatever we wrote had to be sent to him. That is a typewriter age. We had to make 3 copies. First copy goes to Inspector General of Police. And this guy will decide what we publish or don't publish. They will red ink, scratch out, this, that, all editorials, columns, our reports, state assembly, anything. So much so that Times of India once put out a story, wholesale price index has gone up by 1.1%. The censor here said, cut it out. Then Times of India said, sir, this is your Press Information Bureau press release. I'm just reproducing your press release. So it went to absurd lengths. So this IGA became a chief censor and became our editor in Indian Express, Bangalore, where we were under pre-censorship for 19 months. So therefore, when people say in emergency time, you know, the buses ran on time, train ran on time, I said, what are you talking, man? What are you talking? Then I come to the Ministry of Information Broadcasting. Here what happens, V.C. Shukla is the minister and wants to show what he can do during emergency, during a dictatorship, threatens all kinds of people. He wanted Kishore Kumar to sing a jingle in favor of emergency. Kishore Kumar refused. So he told All India Radio, cut out all Kishore Kumar songs. Then people started in the film industry, everything went to him. Then some others went, what are you doing? Kishore Kumar is such a great playback singer and all that. He said, nothing. This has sent the right signal to the film industry, because then many of them came crawling to him. So he says, and it was well possible. And he said, in the manner expected, it has had the desired effect on the film industry. So this is how he made a namuna, or as you say, of one artist. Then the other most interesting thing, those of you who are interested, the book is on sale, you can go and pick it up. February 7, 1977, some of my colleagues from Prasar, Bharati, All India Radio, Doordarshan and all are here. 7th February 1977, 22 translators of DAVP and All India Radio were bundled into cars and taken to a hall and locked up, translators. They were given an 18-page Congress manifesto. They were to sit and translate it into Bengali, Kannada, Tamil, Telugu, blah, 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 blah. Finish the work and then get out. The doors were closed until then. That is the emergency. And those days, no mobile phone, nothing. Some one or two women were there. They kept pleading with their minders. And one or two were allowed to make a call to their houses saying, we are going to come very late. Then naturally, husband will ask, what's the matter? Where are you? No, 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 nothing to be said. And these fellows are watching over them, so that nothing is disclosed. Then we come to Rajan case. Now I'll come to a couple of cases. Horrendous. You know, Rajan, 1st March 1973, he was picked up by police. He was supposed to be a left-wing activist. Picked up from the hostel of our engineering college and picked up by police. After that, he disappears. What happened was, that the police, well, during interrogated him, killed him during interrogation. And his father, Echara Warrior, is going to chief minister. Now, because the courts have said, habeas corpus, you cannot move. So, Echara Warrior has no support. He and his aged, ill wife, desperately moving, knocking on door after door. Nobody told them what had happened to Rajan. Then, the elderly couple always kept the door open and slept at night, saying, Rajan will come back. Rajan will come back. There are one or two poems which Echara Warrior has written, which all of you must read. It is available. On the absence of his son and how he keeps waiting for him. Of course, now both are, his parents are no more. Then, so what happened to Rajan? And what happens to the Rajans of this world when there is a dictatorship? And when Article 14, 21, 22 are all suspended, what happens? 38 years after Rajan's disappearance, the driver of that police van, which had taken his body, told Matrubhumi, Rajan's mutilated body was taken to an animal feed factory in Kootattukulam. The body was first dumped in an ice chamber and then ground to pieces and fed to pigs in a government factory called Meat Products of India, Kootattukulam. This is what happened to Rajan, that engineering college student. And finally, after 38 years, we had a witness who could tell us what had happened to Rajan and his body. His parents, of course, never got to know of that. Then you have Uthavar village in Haryana. 700 policemen surround the village. 550 males, age 8 to 80, taken to Nu and Mandkola. Nu and Mandkola primary health centers and vasectomized. And then dumped back in police vans in the night. 700 policemen surround a village. It's amazing. Then we come to my friend D.P. Tripathi, who is here with us. D.P. Tripathi was president of JNU Students Union. On 25th September 1975, the additional DGP P.S. Binder came to JNU to arrest DPT for protesting against the emergency. I think he was wearing a beard or something in those days. Huh? Somebody told him, he looks like this. So this Binder guy was driving inside JNU. Then somebody said, he is D.P. Tripathi. So they just caught hold of that guy and took him to South Delhi police station, arrested him under MISA. His name was Prabir Purkayastha. Immediately they informed Indira Gandhi's house, we have hit a gold mine. We have arrested D.P. Tripathi. Indira Gandhi's household was thrilled because they wanted D.P. Tripathi. He was president of JNU Students Union and organizing strike against emergency. After one or two days, they realized it is not D.P. Tripathi, but they won't release Prabir Purkayastha because Sanjay Gandhi, Indira Gandhi have been told that D.P. Tripathi is arrested. So how can you release? Prabir Purkayastha, poor guy, he was taken in handcuffs to Naini jail to write his exam. He was also in solitary confinement in Agra. D.P. Tripathi was arrested months later, but even after his arrest, they won't release Prabir Purkayastha. This is what happens in dictatorship when there is no free flow of information. Then we come to the case of Naveen Chawla. Oh. Now we come to the case of Naveen Chawla. Tihar jail could accommodate 1,273 prisoners, but Indira Gandhi arrested 3,500 to 4,000 political prisoners and sent them to jail. Naveen Chawla was secretary to Lieutenant Governor of Delhi. Jail superintendent told Chawla that there is no place for new prisoners. Chawla ordered that cells be built with asbestos roofs for new prisoners in June. He asked the jail superintendent, how will people survive in asbestos cells? He said, bake them. And where is that slide? Oh, there it is. And throw some of the troublesome detainees into the lunatic cell. This is Naveen Chawla. The lieutenant governor, this is amazing, eh? During emergency, what all happened? The This is, I had kept an alarm for my time. Please give me a few more minutes. What do you call it? Katre ki ghanti for a speaker. Okay, sir. Quickly, I'll wind up. The Lieutenant Governor told the Shah Commission that his secretary Navin Chawla had enormous powers when it came to throwing people in jail. He's saying his secretary has enormous power. He also told the commission, I'm very scared of my secretary. He was very scared of Navin Chawla. The commission observed that though Sri Navin Chawla had no position in jail or hierarchy, he was extra statutory control in jail matters. Shah Commission declared Navin Chawla to be unfit to hold any public office which demands an attitude of fair play and consideration for others. Please mark my words. When Indira Gandhi returned to power in 1980, she had copies of the Shah Commission burnt and destroyed. Her successors have done prayaschit for emergency by appointing Navin Chawla, who is declared a tyrant and unfit to hold public office, as an election commissioner. A person who had no commitment to democracy was appointed election commissioner and appointed at a time when he could become the chief election commissioner of India. Even today, I will say, you must get Navin Chawla. You must fix him for what he did during the emergency. Well, can you go and honor these people? I will come to that. Look at this, slide number 12. Bansilal, V.C. Shukla, R.K. Dhawan, Kishan Chen, Navin Chawla, P.S. Bindar, K.S. Bajwa, Jairam Padikkal. Jairam Padikkal is the fellow who killed Rajan. He became DGP in Kerala. All of them got promoted after 1980 when Indira Gandhi came back. Bansilal came back as a railway minister. Then he was the Haryana chief minister twice more. V.C. Shukla again became minister in Rajiv Gandhi government, V.P. Singh government, Narasimha Rao government. P.S. Binder, you know, is a serious blot on the name of administration. This is what Shah Commission said of him. And P.S. Binder became Delhi's police commissioner and DGP. Jairam Padikkal, who killed Rajan and who was prosecuted for that purpose, went on to become DGP. Kishan Chen, Lieutenant Governor, told the Shah Commission he was afraid of his secretary, Navin Chawla. B.D. Gupta, who succeeded Bansilal as Chief Minister of Haryana, told Shah Commission, sir, I was very scared of Bansilal because any time I thought he will arrest me under Misa, the Chief Minister of a state. Then R.K. Dhawan became Minister, MP, BM Minister. Navin Chawla became Chief Election Commissioner. So, where do we go from here? India came under a fascist regime for 21 months during the emergency. The villains of the emergency wrecked our constitution and our democratic way of life. In my view, we must still track them down. The Nazi hunters are still at work, even after 60, 70 years. We should not let go. This, if you care for your constitution and your democratic way of life, then you cannot say all these villains of the emergency can enjoy all this, that and the other. And you see them sometimes, you know, when you go to some of these clubs in Delhi, you suddenly bump into these people. It's very scary actually. God knows when they will come back and do what. Then we must track them down and punish them. Dr. Manmohan Singh must answer why a person described as a tyrant by the Shah Commission was made of all things the election commissioner. On whose instructions did he do this? If we wish to secure our democracy, the villains of the emergency and their mentors must be made to pay. This is what I feel, sir, in regard to whatever has happened at that time. A lot of details are available in the book. And of course, you know, it's a time for a commercial break. This is a book available. And, you know, they say about Gujaratis that they are very money-minded, this, that and the other. But let me tell you that Gujaratis are some of the greatest patriots and nationalists, starting with Sardar Patel, our Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji, and so many, dozens and dozens of them, okay? So, apart from the mercantile this thing approach to things, they are also great nationalists. And I think my publisher Mehul Bhai Gandhi, you see, has taken some lessons from that, and he has brought down the price of the book to almost one-third its price today. It's selling out there. So this is my commercial break. And so finally, sir, for I now end with a couplet which symbolizes determination of those who fought against the emergency. My jhuka nahi, my bika nahi, kahi chup chupa ke khada nahi. Jo date hue mahas par, mujhe un safon mein talash kar. Thank you.